Dragi telespectatori, doresc să vă previn că episodul acesta și încă două episoade ulterioare vă vor afecta emoțional. De ce aceasta? Pentru că în cadrul răspunsurilor pentru viață ne vom referi la una dintre cele mai dramatice întrebări, respectiv la întrebarea: există viață după moarte, există iad, există rai? Practic, doctorul Morris Rawlings, neurochirurg din Statele Unite, a făcut un studiu al vieții de după moarte bazat pe anumite cazuri reale petrecute cu diferite persoane, unele chiar cu pregătire deosebit de înaltă în societate. El însuși s-a întors la Dumnezeu, respectiv a devenit creștin, urmărind o astfel de mărturie sau tratând un pacient care s-a întors pe ultima sută de metri la Dumnezeu și odată cu el și cel care îl trata, respectiv doctorul neurochirurg Morris. Așadar, să urmărim prima parte a acestui material care pune întrebarea: există iad, există rai, există viață după moarte? Și în continuare, în alte două episoade, vom vedea partea a doua și partea a treia. Vizionare plăcută!
Now there are people that talk about a light. There are people that talk about floating above. There are people that talk about a feeling of warmth and love. I didn't feel any of that. I felt none of that. I felt untold terror.
When I came to, Dr. Allen said my hair was literally standing on the end.
It was an incredible experience to see that there is life beyond life.
Everyday people like you and me, living their lives one minute and the next they lay dying, having never known or believed the message of salvation. They traveled from this world to one beyond, but what they found was pure terror. They return, and these are their true stories.
It's very easy to be an atheist when you're successful, but it's very difficult to be an atheist when you're laying on your deathbed.
Tonight, renowned cardiologist and author Dr. Morris Rawlings takes you on a journey few have ever spoken of.
So I called out into the darkness, "Jesus, please save me." And that you could either go to heaven or you'll go to hell, and there ain't nothing else.
Hear the voice of one that has heard the screams.
This may be your only chance to safely go to hell and back.
This is an experiment on life after death. All through history, man has predicted life after death. All Bibles are based on life after death, all religions. But where are they? Who's come back to show us there's life after death? But now, through modern resuscitation methods, bringing the heart back, bringing breathing back, you and I can now bring a whole population of people back to talk to us about what's on the other side of death. See what you believe in some of these cases that we're going to present. The good ones are a dime a dozen because people love to tell about this wonderful experience after I died and I came back. The hell experiences are embarrassing. It's an F on the report card, a slap in the face. But we have some cases we're going to present tonight that tell you about their own hell experiences so that you won't go where they went. Notice that death is reversible. You have 4 minutes survival time of the brain cells without blood flow before rigor mortis sets in. True death sets in where resurrection is required. something man can't do. We can do resuscitation, something God has permitted us to do. And how many hell experiences have had salvation on the floor, conversion on the floor, and only remember the good experiences to report? Such was not the case in Ronald Reagan. He had his little boy with him, was going to a 7-Eleven store, and got in an argument. A bottle was broken. He became stabbed multiple times by his assailant. And then the rest of the story we're going to present to you on film.
In 1972, my life was broken. I was a drug addict. I was a criminal. My family was broken. My wife had filed for divorce a couple of times. My children were afraid of me. I really couldn't hold a job. My mental state was terrible. And it was in that frame of life that I took my 6-year-old son one night and went down to a little market, going inside to purchase some things. And on the way in to that market, I met a gentleman coming out the door, and an argument erupted. And before I knew it, I had just hit him, knocked him down, and he fell into a stack of bottles. The bottles bursted, and immediately he leaped up with a broken bottle and began to stab at me. I lifted my left arm to try to stop the blow, and the bottle actually severed the biceps muscle, the major arteries in my arm, and I was bleeding to death in just a matter of seconds. But full of anger and hatred and rage, I kept fighting and kept bleeding. My little son was screaming. He was hysterical. But the man that ran the store came over and said, if you don't get to a hospital, you'll bleed to death in just a few minutes. So he actually took me in my own automobile to the hospital. And when we entered the emergency room, I was barely conscious. And as the medical attendants began to work on me, I could hear their voices. And I could hear them saying, we can't help him. He'll have to be transported to another hospital. Probably will lose the arm. And as they loaded me into an ambulance, my wife had arrived by that time and got in the ambulance with me. But as they pulled out of the parking lot of that hospital, a young paramedic looked down into my face, and I could barely see him. I was so weak. But he said, sir, you need Jesus Christ. And I didn't know Jesus. I didn't know what he was talking about. So my reaction to that was to begin cursing. And again, he stated to me, you need Jesus. And as he was talking to me, it appeared like the ambulance literally exploded in flames. I thought it had actually blown up. It filled with smoke. And immediately I was moving through that smoke as if through a tunnel. And after some period of time, coming out of the smoke and out of the darkness, I began to hear the voices of a multitude of people screaming and groaning and crying. But as I looked down, the sensation was looking down upon a volcanic opening and seeing fire and smoke and people inside of this burning place screaming and crying. They were burning, but they weren't burning up. They weren't being consumed. And then the sensation of moving downward into this.
He was thrashing, just thrashing about, you know, and moaning and groaning. And it was like there was a battle going on. I wasn't a Christian at the time, and I didn't even know anything about spiritual battles. But it was scary to me in the fact that I could feel it. I could feel it was like light and darkness. It was like he was fighting against something. And I didn't know what, But now I know, you know, he was seeing the vision of hell.
But the most terrible part of it, I began to recognize many of the people that I was seeing in these flames, as if a close-up lens on a camera was bringing their faces close to me. I could see their features and see the agony and the pain and the frustration. And a number of them began to call my name and said, "Ronnie, don't come to this place. There's no way out. There's no escape. If you come here, there's no way out." And I looked into the faces of one that had died in a robbery attempt, who had been shot to death and bled to death on the sidewalk. And I looked in the face of two others that had died drunk in an automobile accident. And I looked into the face of others that had died of drug overdoses that we had partied together, and the agony and the pain. But I believe the most painful part of it was the loneliness. And the depression was so heavy that there was no hope. There was no escape. There was no way out of this place. And the smell was like sulfur, like an electric welder. And the stench was terrible. And as I looked at this, I had seen people killed. I had been involved in fights where people were killed. I've done time in prison for manslaughter myself. I grew up basically in a reform school and in a jail cell. I was beat on mercifully as a child by a father that had temper problems and alcohol problems. I was a runaway at 12 years old, and I felt like there was nothing in this world that could frighten me. My life was wrecked. My marriage was wrecked. My health was wrecked. But now I'm seeing something that literally scares me to death because I don't understand it. And as I'm looking into this pit, this place of fire and screams and torment, I just fade out into blackness. And when I open my eyes, I'm in a hospital room in Knoxville, Tennessee. My wife is sitting by. There have been multiple stitches put in my body. My arm was spared. There were almost 100 stitches. And I looked in the face of my wife, and I wasn't concerned about where I was or anything around me. All I could visualize was what I had just seen.
He had this funny look on his face, and it was a terrifying look. And he said, "I don't really know what's happened to me," but he said, "I've been in a terrible place." And I kept telling him, "You're in the hospital. You've been in the hospital all along." And he kept saying, "No." He said, "I've been in another place." He said, "I don't know exactly what it was, but," he said, "it was terrible. It's a terrible place."
I could still hear the screams. I could still smell the terrible smell. I could still feel the heat. And I could still hear the voices of people that I'd known through the years screaming for me to go back. And through the days to come, I tried every way to get that out of my mind. I tried to get drunk. I could not get drunk. I tried to get stoned. I could not get stoned. I tried everything that I could to get this off my mind, and I could not. One morning, several months later, I came home to where my wife was. I'd been trying to get drunk. I couldn't. And when I walked in the house, went back to the bedroom, the light was burning. My wife was sitting up in bed, and she had a large book open on her lap. And she looked up at me, and her face was literally shining. And she said, "Ronnie, tonight I accepted the Lord Jesus Christ as my Savior." And she didn't have to say a lot to me. Our life had been filled with agony. She grew up in Chicago. Her father was a bartender on the south side of Chicago. She knew nothing about God or church or religion. And the pain in her face, the wrinkles that I'd put in her face with abuse and violence and alcoholism and drug addiction, being gone for months at a time and her and the kids not knowing where I was. Her face had changed. The wrinkles were literally gone. The smile had replaced the sorrow and agony. And she looked at me and she said, "Jesus, save me tonight." And she said, "Would you go with me and hear about this man called Jesus?" And I thought for a second and I thought, I've tried everything else in life. Nothing has worked for me. The people that I love most of all, my wife and my children, I'm terrible to them. And I agreed to go with her. And a couple of weeks later on a Sunday morning, a matter of fact, the date was November the 2nd, 1972. Just before 12 o'clock a.m., a minister stood to read from the Bible. I was sitting in the back of the building. I didn't know anything out of the Bible. I did not know how to act in church. But the minister stood to read from the Bible, and he read from the Gospel of John. And he began to read these words that said, "Behold the Lamb of God that takes away the sin of the world." When he said the Lamb, he had my attention. It wouldn't have meant anything to me, any other passage. But when he mentioned the Lamb, he had this hard-hearted sinner's attention. Because when I was 9 years old, a very poor child in the mountains of eastern Tennessee with a father that only knew anger and abuse and alcohol, a neighbor had given me a baby lamb. And I had to walk 2 miles to catch the school bus. And coming through her yard, she stopped me one day and said, "Son, I have a gift for you." And she showed me this baby lamb. And I took that lamb home with me. It was my friend, the only friend I felt like I had. And it was such a friend in days and weeks to come. It followed me, and it would meet me when I got off the school bus and came walking through the woods and the fields. One evening as I came in, the lamb was missing. And I heard my father cursing and screaming, and I looked up to the side of the house. And there he was working on an old model car, changing a flat tire by hand the old way. And I tried to walk around because I didn't want to be cursed. And I tried to bypass him. And when I got on the other side of the car, I looked down, and there was my lamb with blood all over the white wool and a tar tool sticking in its body. The lamb had come around just wanting to be curious. And in a drunken fit of anger, and my father had plunged the tire iron through that lamb's body. And when I saw my lamb, my friend, dead, I began to scream as a 9-year-old child. I run into the woods screaming, "He's killed my lamb. He's killed the lamb." And at 9 years old, hatred and violence took my life, possessed my life. And from that point, I was never, ever the same. By 12 years old, I was a runaway. I was in the juvenile system, arrested time after time after time. There was no respect for authority. I hated anyone that represented authority over me. And by the time I was 15 years old, I had been in jail for car theft, for stealing. And at 15 years old, I was sentenced for manslaughter, involved in a car accident that had taken life and crippled others for life. Wondering at that time if life ever would hold anything for me. But when that minister mentioned the Lamb, He had my attention. And he said, Jesus Christ is God's Lamb. And he died and he shed his blood that whosoever will could have a new start, could be forgiven, could start over. That morning, as I stood to try to leave the building, I thought, I don't want anybody to see me cry. I've not cried since I was 9 years old. I'm not afraid of any living thing on this earth, and no one's going to see me cry. But I turned to leave, but I started down the aisle toward the front of that building. And my prayer was this. I didn't know the sinner's prayer. I didn't know the Roman road of salvation. But my prayer was this. God, if you exist, and Jesus, if you are God's Lamb, please, please kill me or cure me. I don't want to live anymore. I'm not a husband. I'm not a father. I'm no good. And at that instant, it was like the darkness and the blackness left my life, and the tears began to flow. And for the first time since I was 9 years old, the tears did run, and the guilt left my life, and the violence and the anger and the hatred left my life, and Jesus Christ became Lord and Savior of my life that morning. And since that time, I didn't know what would happen, but God healed my mind, my memory. The drug addiction, the alcoholism was instantaneously gone, delivered. And from that moment, I knew that I had to tell the story of what had happened to me. My life was only spared to tell others about the place that I had seen and the hope of Jesus Christ to save mankind from this terrible fate.
Here we are again, wondering whether hell is for the bad guys or the good guys. I'd like to introduce the subject's OBE, NDE. You know what clinical death is, where heart stops, breathing stops, and we start life again, restart the breathing in the heart. They come from death back to life, a reversible situation before rigor mortis sets in. Out-of-the-body experiences and near-death experiences are entirely different. Near-death experience, I hold a gun up at you and say, give me your money. You may get scared to death, but that's a near-death experience. But you didn't come anywhere near dying. Almost near-crash auto accident. That's a near-death experience, but nothing involving stopping the heart, stopping breathing. And yet, most of the authors that write these books are including NDEs and OBEs with clinical death. We're just investigating clinical death, where people actually die and come back. Now, out-of-the-body experiences is a way to get there without dying. How'd you like to find out what death feels like without dying? Well, deep hypnosis can get you there. You see your guru over in India and learn the meditation techniques and the correct mantra. You can have chemical hypnosis. You can go scrying with your crystal ball. You can have kundalini, the electrical stimulus of the coiled snake down the base of the spine, the chakral sites, and all of the acupuncture is based upon ways of getting out of the body to experience life beyond the body, separating spirit from the body. This is the definition in the Bible, when the spirit separates from the body, but they're talking about a permanent separation, not a man-made separation. And we, in turn, are talking nothing about NDEs or OBEs. We're talking about clinical death. And this is where the great majority of the people that have true experiences occur. One of the cases we're going to show tonight is Charles McCaig, a 57-year-old mail carrier. He was having chest pain. We took him to the office, put him on a treadmill, and started the treadmill until he got his chest pain again. He was attached to an EKG. The EKG went haywire. We knew he had chest pain. Before we could stop the machine, he dropped dead. Unfortunate. Only one in 5,000 do that, so don't be afraid of EKG stress test. But when he dropped dead, he had a very peculiar situation. He convulsed like most people do when they first die and the heart stops supplying blood to the brain. Eyes rolled up, sputtered, turned blue, stopped breathing. The nurse started IV. I started external heart massage. The strangest thing happened when I would stop resuscitating to put in a pacemaker.
When I came to, Dr. Allen said my hair was literally standing on the end and my eyes had already started dilating. And I was absolutely scared to death. I was horrified. My life was what you might call normal. I partied lots. Not all that bad, but I had joined the church at a small, young age because my parents had said, let's go down to the front and join the church. I really didn't realize what it was to belong to a church or accept Christ until that day. And I had early in one morning at work, I had gone to the, walked to the local clinic in my hometown. And telling them that I thought I was having a heart attack. I didn't tell anyone I was going, and they sent me on up to the clinic where Dr. Rollins was. He kept me about 3 or 4 days and then gave me a stress test. On that stress test, I told the girl, Pam, that was running the stress test that I was dying, let me off, and that's the last I remember of that. And when I came to, Dr. Rollins was giving me CPR. And he asked me what was the matter because I was looking so scared and so forth. And I had told him I'd been to hell, I needed help. And he said, well, keep your health to yourself. I'm a doctor, I'm trying to save your life. You need a minister for that. As he was giving me CPR, he was trying to install a pacemaker with the other hand and doing it with one. I would fade out. And then he'd start again and bring me back. I watched what was going on, like some people say I was floating in air or up on the ceiling. I was up above it and could look down and see things. And I kept asking, please help me, please help me. I don't want to go back to hell. And Pam said, well, he needs help, do something. And at that time, he said, say this short prayer after me.
I believe Jesus Christ is the Son of God.
If you'll save my soul and keep me alive, I'll be on the hook for you forever.
And if I die, please keep me out of hell.
And after that, the other experiences was real pleasant. I saw my stepmother, my mother. My mother passed away when I was about 5 months old. I never saw a photograph of her. And I was able to recognize who she was. And my stepmother had passed away approximately 10 years before. They were together. I did not have any contact physically or mentally with them. All I remember was they kept their hands outreached to me. And I remember later that I made a remark that I'd always heard it, but now I knew it. And Dr. Rollins asked me, what did I mean? And I said, well, I've always heard you couldn't carry your money with you. And I looked, and they didn't have pockets. I know that's weird, but I was trying to take in everything I could see. I must have thought I was going to get back so I could tell it. And after I saw them, my next experience was walking down a lane that had colors on both sides, just brilliant colors. I have dabbled in art, and or Rembrandt, either one, could not produced those colors. They were so bright. This light surrounded me, and I believe to this day that was the Holy Spirit that surrounded me and took care of me. And I've never felt so good and so safe in all my life.
After all this was over, I realized what had really happened. It was a double conversion. Not only had this make-believe prayer converted this atheist on the floor, it had also converted this atheist doctor that it was working on him. That's the only reason I can appear to you here now, to tell you that there is a life after death, and it ain't all good.